Ladies and gentlemen, hope all is well. Today is a follow-up video to a video I did not long ago, which included some details about Brett Kavanaugh and the Christy Ford case. Today is just a compilation of videos I thought were interesting, commentary about what's going on.
Right. So, as you know, Justice Anthony Kennedy is retiring from the Supreme Court, and Trump nominated Brett Kavanaugh, a current circuit judge, on the U.S. Court of Appeals for the D.C. Circuit. When judges issue rulings on cases, the attached legal analysis is referred to as an opinion. These opinions become public record, so Kavanaugh's legal track record, as it were, is available for the public to see. He hasn't made any obscene, improper, or horrible rulings. In less partisan times, Kavanaugh is the type of middle-of-the-road, conservative-leaning judge that would be nominated by a 98-2 vote with limited drama and consternation. But we no longer live in times like that. We live in clown world. And so, less than a week before the September 20th Judiciary Committee vote on Kavanaugh's confirmation, the left has decided to dig into their war chest and pull out the weapon they have tried to wield against almost every prominent Republican candidate they oppose. Accusations of sexual impropriety. Flashback to the 2016 race, where, just a week before the election, women came out of the woodwork to claim that Trump had, 30 years ago, touched them inappropriately in some way.
She has to testify. And look, nobody should be referring to her as a victim or him as a perpetrator until we hear from both of them under oath, subject to cross-examination. There is nothing more essential to American justice than the opportunity to cross-examine your accuser, to confront your accuser. It's in the Constitution. Essentially, it goes back to Magna Carta. The idea that we're calling somebody a perpetrator and somebody else a victim based simply on he said, she said, is just wrong and it's un-American. Well, it's not.
The FBI has no jurisdiction over this kind of. For the sake of this discussion, if there was illegality and there's no evidence, Dr. Ford said there is, Brett Kavanaugh says they're not. That's not the FBI doesn't investigate that. What do? They do background checks. Now, this information is already public. So I think the appropriate thing to do here is to allow Dr. Ford to have the opportunity to address her allegations in a setting that she's comfortable with, whether it's publicly or privately, under oath.
But look, Jay, who's a great lawyer, is partly right and partly wrong. They have no jurisdiction to investigate a crime, but they do have jurisdiction to do a background evaluation. A background evaluation, I know we've all been asked. People come to you and say, do you know him? What do you think of him? They can do a background evaluation, but they can do it after her testimony. It makes much more sense for her to testify. She's not going to learn anything new from the FBI investigation. Her testimony won't change based on the FBI investigation. She testifies. If she provides new information, the FBI can look into it then.
And this is a woman, and I really believe, who's been profoundly impacted by this. Now, I can't say everything's truthful. I don't know. Right. Now, I can't say everything's truthful. I don't know.
Right. What do you make of the fact that Dianne Feinstein is saying, I'm not sure I believe Christine Ford now?
I mean, that's the direction it's going. The Democrats had a sole purpose, right? They wanted to delay and defeat this nominee at all costs. I think what's sort of breaking down is the Democratic story here to somebody.
The woman's story?
Well, we're going to hear it out. Yeah. But, 36 years ago, and from what I read, she can't tell you where it was, how she got there, how she left. I don't know that anybody can really remember.
She doesn't really recall how she got to the party. She doesn't recall the house that the thrown in, and she doesn't recall how she got home from the party. She's a little fuzzy about the people that were there at the time, and there was some discrepancy with the notes that her therapist took. And she admits that she was drinking.
So you're saying even if they say the FBI will investigate and begins an investigation, you're saying Monday there's no way your client would sit down in front of a hearing even if the FBI said, okay, we've looked into it?
It's premature to talk about a hearing.
Not only do women like Dr. Ford, who bravely comes forward, need to be heard, not only do women like Dr. Ford, who bravely comes forward, need to be heard, but they need to be believed. Guess who's perpetuating all of these kinds of actions? It's the men in this country. And I just want to say to the men in this country, just shut up and step up. Do the right thing for a change.
Did you catch that? It's not just Brett Kavanaugh who's guilty. It's, quote, the men of this country, every single one of them. Democrats explained today there is nothing Brett Kavanaugh could do to prove his innocence. Senator Tim Kaine of Virginia, for example, was asked how exactly Kavanaugh might clear his name. The senator's reply, quote, that's kind of very hypothetical.
Now, I can't say everything's truthful. I don't know.
The woman accusing President Trump's Supreme Court nominee of physical and sexual assault may indeed testify next week. But an attorney for Christine Blasey Ford says it will not be Monday, the day the Senate Judiciary Committee had scheduled for a hearing, and Judge Brett Kavanaugh, the president's nominee, is set to be there. However, there are so many other details that are out being negotiated right now, sort of reopens the door to those conversations between Capitol Hill and Professor Ford. Also breaking right now, the senator overseeing this hearing, the Judiciary Chair, Chuck Grassley, is now dealing with protests and arrests happening outside of his office. So let's go up to Capitol Hill and CNN congressional correspondent Sunlin Sarfati. And Sunlin, let's just start on the breaking news, because I've got this letter from Ford's attorney to Capitol Hill saying she wishes to testify as long as they guarantee her safety.
That's right. This is a significant development, and a significant development, I should add, the fact that they are continuing to communicate, the attorneys for Ford and the chairman of the committee. Now, this is a letter that was sent from Dr. Ford's attorney to the Senate Judiciary Chairman, saying that she is prepared to potentially testify next week. As you note, though, they said Monday will not work for them, essentially, but they say she wishes to testify, provided that we can agree on terms that are fair and which ensure her safety. They also go on in this letter, notably, Brooke, to again say that their strong preference would be to have the FBI investigation first, but they did not stipulate that was required for her to testify, and that's an important point here. So the big question, of course, is what, of course, are those fair terms that they outlined? And that really is important, because that's where the devil is in the details now, and where, honestly, this could either come together or fail and fall apart again.